Good morning and welcome to Smith Chapel AME Church. We are so excited to have you worshiping with us today. My name is Pastor Kay, and I invite you to join in our virtual worship experience. Now listen, we've got a chat box right there. We'd love for you to put your name and where you're worshiping from. And if you are ready to praise the Lord today, just go ahead and drop in that box, amen. So come on, let's get ready to worship God together.
www.ascensiontrack.com.
Everywhere you go, there is trouble.
There is trouble.
Everywhere you go, there is strife.
There is strife.
Everywhere you go, there is something that's worrying you. But remember,
my God is standing by.
Everywhere you go, there is strife.
There is strife.
Everywhere you go, there is something that worries you. But remember,
my God is standing by.
Oh, God is standing by.
No need to cry.
God is standing near.
No need to fear.
He will be right there.
He's everywhere.
Yeah, he'll roll the clouds away.
Yeah,
he'll hear you when you pray.
Oh yes,
he'll catch you when you fall.
Yeah,
catch you when you fall.
Oh yes,
Jesus will be your friend.
Yeah,
right on to the end. Just remember,
my God is standing by.
God is standing near.
No need to fear.
He will be right there.
He's everywhere.
Yeah, he'll roll the clouds away.
Yeah,
he'll roll the clouds away.
Oh yeah,
he'll roll the clouds away.
Yeah,
he'll roll the clouds away.
Oh yeah,
he'll roll the clouds away.
Yeah,
he'll roll the clouds away.
Yeah,
he'll roll the clouds away.
Yeah,
pray.
Oh yes,
he'll hear you when you 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 pray.
Oh yes,
Jesus will be your friend.
Oh yes,
Jesus will be your friend.
Oh yes,
all you gotta do is trust him.
Oh yes,
he will be your friend.
Oh yes,
lean on him.
Oh yes,
lean on him.
Oh yes,
Jesus will be your friend.
Oh yes.
Right on to the end. Just remember,
my God is standing by.
God is standing by.
No need to cry.
Oh, God is standing there.
No need to fear.
Yeah, he will be right there.
He's everywhere.
Hey, I tell you, he'll roll the clouds away.
Yeah.
Pray.
Oh, yes.
He hear you when you call.
Yes.
He'll catch you before you fall.
Oh, yes.
He hear you when you call.
Yes.
He'll catch if when you fall,
yes.
Jesus will be your friend.
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 Yes.
Right on to the end. Just remember
that. My God is standing by.
It's prayer time this morning. In the book of Philippians, Paul reminds us to be anxious for nothing, but to, in all things, come to God in prayer with thanksgiving in our hearts. And then it talks about that the grace of God will cover our hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. And so I don't know what may have been making you anxious this week. I don't know what possibly has caused you to toss and to turn. But this morning, if you would like to, the chat box is open for you to put your prayer request in there. What I do know is that God will guard your heart and mind. See, I love the second part of that scripture because sometimes we pray about things and it doesn't turn out as quickly as we would like to. It doesn't turn out the way we thought it would turn out. And sometimes we're just still in that waiting place. But you can still have joy and you can still have peace while you wait because God will guard your heart and your mind. And so today, if you would just simply release it in prayer, if you would cast your cares on God because God cares, we're going to take it not to Facebook. It's nothing wrong. We know that Facebook creates a community for us to be able to encourage one each other. But that's not where we're taking it today. We're not calling our girlfriends. We're not going in the group me or the text chain. But we are going to take it to God. So come on this morning. Let's pray. God, in the name of Jesus, we come to you right now, God, first of all, saying thank you. God, we thank you for your grace and we thank you for your mercy. We thank you for your provision and we thank you for your protection. God, we thank you because you've just been good. Oh, we thank you, God, that you've been so good. And we stand on the promises found in the book of Romans, the 8th chapter and the 28th verse that says that you allow all things to work together for our good. God, we've got joy today because we remember that word says, oh, not some things, not most things, but all things will work together for our good. And so, Lord, we come and we join in worship today, Lord. And we were looking for an exchange because we heard somebody that says that when praises go up, blessings come down. And so, God, we simply come today to praise your name, to magnify your name, to glorify your name, for you are worthy. Oh, you're worthy to be praised. Then, God, we come with some things today that have been on our hearts and our minds, and we come against fear. We come against anxiety. We come against stress. We come against distress, God, and we speak peace, oh, to every situation in our lives. We speak peace, be still. But, Lord, we come and we pray. Lord, we come and we lift them up before you. God, we come and we lay them at your feet. God, we come and we lay our burdens down so that we might experience rest. And so, Lord, in this service today, I pray that you would change some hearts and that you would change some minds. Lord, I pray that you would mend some relationships. I pray that you would restore some finances. God, I pray that you would do the thing that only you can do. Because, God, we trust you to be transformer and deliverer and holy God, Messiah. So do what only you can do, God. And then, God, as we give this thing to you, we expect the second part of that verse that says that you will guard our hearts and our minds. God, keep us in perfect peace as long as we keep our minds stayed upon you, God. So, Lord, in this worship experience, we ask that you would just have your way right now. God, we ask that you would touch, Lord, the praise team in the name of Jesus, that you would touch the preacher in the name of Jesus, and you would touch everybody that's listening right now and those who will listen later. And we pray that when we leave this place, whether it be through Zoom, Facebook, YouTube, oh God, that we will be changed. So get the glory. 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 This we pray in the strong and mighty name of Jesus. And the people of God said, amen, amen, and amen. The scripture reading this morning can be found in the book of Joshua, the 24th chapter, and we're going to begin reading with the 14th verse. That's Joshua 24 and 14. Hear the word of the Lord. Now fear the Lord and serve him with all faithfulness. Throw away the God your ancestors worshiped beyond the Euphrates River and in Egypt and serve the Lord. But if serving the Lord seems undesirable to you, then choose for yourselves this day whom you will serve, whether the God of your ancestors served beyond the Euphrates or the God of the Amorites in whose land you are living. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. I'm going to read that verse again. But as for me and my household, we will serve the Lord. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. For the Bible tells me so. For the Bible tells me so.
Good morning, young people. You know what time it is. It's time for our children's message. And I am so excited to spend some time with you this morning. So I've got with me today a puzzle. How many of you love puzzles? Oh, come on, let me know if you love puzzles. And this question is not even just for the young people, for the adults too. Go ahead and put in the chat box, let me know if you love puzzles. You know, it's interesting, during this quarantine, I found that a lot of people were doing puzzles to pass the time. My brother, my nephew, just other people that I was talking to really enjoyed doing puzzles. So when I take a look at this puzzle, there are so many different pieces to this puzzle. There's different shapes of the pieces. There's different colors of the puzzle. And each of the pieces of this puzzle is so very important to completing the entire picture. If not all the pieces of the puzzle are there, we don't have a full picture. You know, it's very interesting when I look at the puzzle and the shapes and pieces of the puzzle, what I understand is that each of them interlock together and they actually connect to complete the puzzle. But wait a minute, I'm taking a look at my puzzle and do you guys see what I see? There's a piece missing from my puzzle, so our picture is not complete. But there's good news. I have the piece of the puzzle. You know what? You are that piece of the puzzle. The body of Christ, Smith Chapel, youth ministry, all of the various ministries that make up this church do not work without each and every single one of you. See, together we make this beautiful picture, but our picture is not complete without each person playing their part and playing their position. See, God looks at the picture, and it's not complete when there's a piece like we had in the middle missing. But God needs each and every single one of us with our talents, with our gifts, with the things that we do very well, with the things that we do like nobody else. Remember what we talked about last week? With your swag to complete the puzzle and to make the complete picture. Today we're going to have a sermon about unity and how it takes every single person playing their part, doing what they have been created by God to do for ministry to work. And so I'm super excited because, guys, this is the first Sunday of our new conference year. And when I look at our picture, I believe that our future is great. In fact, I believe one of the scriptures that says, eyes have not seen, ears have not heard, nor has it entered into the hearts of man what God wants to do through us. But this picture will not be complete without each and every one of you. And so I want you to open up your eyes, your ears, and your heart today when we talk about this sermon. And I want you to begin to think, what can I do this year to help to grow the body of Christ at Smith Chapel? Because we need you. This puzzle was not complete until we put in that piece, and the work that we have to do here will not be complete without each and every single one of you. So we're going to get ready to pray. But today I am going to pray specifically that God would speak to your heart and show you that thing, that talent you're supposed to display here at church, that ministry you would start, something that you just haven't shown up for. Maybe you haven't been consistent. God is going to show you what you need to do to help us make the complete picture and the idea of what God has in store for this ministry. Come on, guys, let's pray. God, in the name of Jesus, I thank you that we were all fearfully and wonderfully made. Lord, I thank you that we have been created in your image. I thank you, God, that you don't make junk. And I thank you, God, that there is a peace, there is a place, there is a position for each of us. God, I thank you that you don't leave anyone out. And when you look over our ministry, you go, it's not complete without KJ. It's not complete without Bryson. It's not complete without Lyric. It's not complete without Jordan. It's not complete without Emily. God, that you need every single one of us to be a part. And so, Lord, I pray that you will speak to our hearts and show us where we need to show up for you, God, so that you can be glorified in us and that we can grow the kingdom of God together at Smith Chapel. I thank you, God, that you've made us all unique and shaped differently, just like the pieces of this puzzle, but we all fit together to complete the picture. And so, Lord, today we say that we're available and ready to be used by you. This we pray in Jesus' name, and the people of God said, amen, amen, amen. Remember, you have a piece of the puzzle and you fit into the bigger picture of what God wants to do at Smith Chapel AME Church. Well, God bless you. I love you. And I'll see you next week.
Well, I feel good this morning.
Yeah,
got my cousin on the organ with us this morning. Dr. Grenae Hunter, we're going to tell you about being signed up for the Jubilee. Y'all ready? Come on, ladies. Give my cousin, Dr. Hunter, a hand. Here we go.
Sign me up
for the Christian Jubilee.
that we would continue to worship in our giving. Giving is worship. It's saying, Lord, I honor you. Lord, I trust you, especially with my money. Now, here's the amazing thing. God just simply asked that we would give back a portion of what has been given to us. We have a few ways that you can give at Smith Chapel. You can give electronically via PayPal or Givelify. Or take a look at the screen right there. You see that QR code? You can take your phone and hover it right over that code, and it'll take you directly to our Givelify page. Or you can mail your offering into the church. We have a prayer that we pray at Smith Chapel to have healthy, giving, and cheerful hearts. So I'm going to ask that you would lift up your offering before the Lord and pray this prayer with me. Let us pray. Lord, help me to grasp that all the money I think I have is really yours. Help me to grasp that all the money our church has is not the church's, but it's yours. Give us healthy, giving hearts to use these funds according to your purpose. The Lord says, give, and I'll give it back to you, pressed down, shaken together, running over. Will God give it back to you?
Give and I'll give it back to you. Give and I'll give it back to you. Give and I'll give it back. I press it down, shake it together, running over. Back in good measure, I'll give it back to you.
I have the honor and privilege today of introducing today's preacher. He's somebody that I've known a very, very, very long time, and he is someone who is very special to me. He has been in ministry for 40 years. He accepted his call to preach when he was just 18 years old, and he has pastored several churches in the Baptist denomination, and he has been pastoring in the AME church for 25 so years. He is a husband. He is a father. He is a grandfather. He is the executive director of a program in the state of Illinois that helps those with disabilities to get the resources they need to live independently. Many call him pastor, but I call him daddy. And so our preacher today will be my dad, Pastor John, as the men have begun to call him in men's Bible study, Reverend John S. Herring, Sr., the pastor of Trinity AME Church in Alton, Illinois. Today, he has a word. He has a word for all of us, a word about unity, cooperation, and what God will do when we lock together like the pieces of a puzzle and let God move through us. And so after this next selection, the next voice that you will hear will be none other than my father. So you know what we do. We like to give preaching orders here at Smith Chapel. So go ahead and stretch your hand towards your screen right now. And we're going to go ahead and pray for the man of God. And we're going to speak to him right now and say, preach, daddy, preach. Come on and preach the word, dad.
Thank you. for letting me see the sunshine of a brand new day. Oh, grant mercy along with each new day.
That's why I praise you.
That's why I praise you.
For this I give.
Sunday of a brand new conference year. Glad that I was asked by your pastor and my daughter, the Reverend Katrese McKenzie, to bring the message on this morning. And I pray that God will bless us as we go through this service. So let us begin in prayer. Father, Father God, as we come to you this morning, we come with a bowed down head and an uplifted heart. We come and ask you to increase this morning. Allow us to decrease. Ask you, Father God, to use us. Use us as an instrument of thy peace. Use us, Father God, to uplift hearts and encourage minds. Father God, now if there be any praise, honor, or glory, we want to give it back to you. Now we pray that the words of our mouth, the meditation of our heart, we pray that they will be accepted in thy sight. We add this in the loving name of your mighty master son, Jesus the Christ, we pray. Amen. So we have a scripture from the Old Testament this morning that I'm sure many, if not all of you, are very familiar with. If you turn with me to Joshua, the 24th chapter, and the 15th verse, I'm going to be reading from two versions, so we're praying that you will get that with us, and then we will begin by reading from the Message Bible. And the Message Bible says, if you decide that it's a bad thing to worship God, then choose a God you'd rather serve. And do it today. Choose one of the gods your ancestors worshiped from the country beyond the river, or one of the gods of the Amorites on whose land you're now living. As for me and my family, we'll worship God. And then from the New English Translation Bible, it reads thusly, if you have no desire to worship the Lord, choose today whom you will worship. Whether it be the God whom your ancestors worshiped beyond the Euphrates, or the God of the Amorites in whose land you are living. But I and my family will worship the Lord. From the topic, it takes a village. Let us this morning go into this conference year having a family affair. So this morning, again, this first Sunday of your new conference year, let's agree that we are a family of baptized believers. We are a subset of the village. Who is the village? The village is the entirety of the Christian community. Those that are in our Zion and those that are throughout Christendom. So we're the village that have chosen to worship in this part of the vineyard. At Smith Chapel, African Methodist Episcopal Church, it is up to us to show the world how to enjoy the goodness of the Lord while having a praise party. We got to have a family affair this conference year. We've got to hold up the bloodstained banner. We've got to let those around us know that there is a reality in serving a living God. So let me say that in order to have a true praise party, I heard somebody years ago say this, ain't no party like the Holy Ghost party, because the Holy Ghost party don't stop. In order to have that type of party, in order to have this family affair during this conference year that we're talking about, in order to have this celebration with the Lord each and every day of our life, we must take notes from Joshua. So in following Joshua's lead, we must first declare among ourselves, not as a church, not as a steward board, not as a choir, but we've got to individually come to the conclusion that Joshua came to. We have got to declare that we will choose to serve or worship him. So my prayer this morning, first of all, is that the Smith Chapel family, individually as well as collectively, has made the decision to worship him. So let's look at what happens once that decision has been made. Then the village must come together. We must come together as a village, as a whole, so that we can conduct this family affair. In the 24th chapter of Joshua calls all the tribes. He calls all the villages of Israel together. He called them together to convince them to make the on again, off again affair with God, a permanent, lifelong decision. I know none of you have been on again and off again with God, but I'm sure you know people that shout so high on Sunday and begin living low on Monday. That's on again, off again. When Joshua had those types of people that he was speaking to in these villages. This morning I want to use the acronym of affair. I want to use that acronym, A-F-F-A-I-R, to look at the case that he makes to these villages. To look at the case that he makes and pleads with them in order for them to solidify this affair. So to begin, At his first point, which you can find by reading verses 5 through 13 of this chapter, he asked them to A, acknowledge God. He reminded them of what God had done for their ancestors. Listen to what he tells them, how God had blessed them. He went on to say, I took your ancestors, Abraham, from the far side of the river. I led him all over the land of Canaan and multiplied his descendants. I gave him Isaac. Then I gave Isaac Jacob and Esau. I let Esau have the mountains of Seir as home. But Jacob and his sons ended up in Egypt. I sent Moses and Aaron. I hid Egypt hard with plagues and then led you out of there. I brought your ancestors out of Egypt. You came to the sea. The Egyptians, which was in hot pursuit with chariots and cavalry, to the very edge of the Red Sea, they followed you. Then they cried out, your ancestors cried out for help to God. He put a cloud between you and the Egyptians. Then he let the sea loose on them. It drowned them. You remember the story. Mountains on each side, Pharaoh and his army behind them, the Red Sea in front of them. And all of a sudden, God parted the sea. They walked across on dry land. Well, somebody said that it was just puddle. Well, if it was a puddle, God is still God. Because Pharaoh and his army drowned in that puddle. So you watched the whole thing with your own eyes. What I did to Egypt. And then you lived in the wilderness for a long time. I brought you to the country of the Amorites, who lived east of the Jordan, and they fought you. But I fought for you, and you took the land. I destroyed them for you. Then Balak, son of Zippor, made his appearance. He was the king of Moab. He got ready to fight Israel by sending for Balaam, son of Beor, to come and curse you. But I wouldn't listen to Balaam. He ended up blessing you over and over. See, I even saved you from Balaam. You then crossed the Jordan and came to Jericho. The Jericho leaders gained up on you, as well as the Amorites, the Perizzites, the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Girgashites, the Hivites, and the Jebusites. But you know what? I turned them over to you. I gave you victory over each and every one of them. I sent the hornet ahead of you. It drove out the two Amorite kings. It did your work for you. You didn't have to do a thing. You didn't even have to lift or raise a finger. I handed you a land for which you did not work, town you did not build. And here you are now, living in them and eating from vineyards and olive groves that you did not plant. So what was Joshua doing as he explained this work of God to them? Joshua wanted these villages, just like God wants us today, to see that this was the result of their ancestor decision. This was the result of their ancestor choosing to recognize God as Jehovah Roha. Smith Chap, they acknowledge God. And as we celebrate, as we have this family affair during this conference year, don't forget to acknowledge God as the Good Shepherd, Jehovah Roha. We got a man named David who knew all about shepherding. And it was him who said that the Lord is my shepherd. And because of that, I shall not want. If you make God and acknowledge God as your shepherd, as your Jehovah Roha, according to David, there's nothing that you will want for. So in the second point, verses 14a, Joshua asked them to fear or reverence God. Joshua wanted the tribes, he wanted the villages to have a sincere praise party by fearing or referencing God and God alone. Ecclesiastes 12 and 13 said, let us hear the conclusion of the entire matter, that we must fear God with all of our heart. We must reverence God and let him know that he is God and God alone. He tells them, Joshua tells them, so now fear God, worship him in total commitment. Joshua knew that they should and could worship him because he is Jehovah Shema. He is the ever-present one. God is everywhere. He's everywhere at the same time. After Joshua's declaration of commitment in verse 15, the villagers are eager to take part in this family affair. They're eager to take part in this affair and this worship that Joshua has with God, with the Lord. Joshua's third point is captured in verses 16 through 18, where the tribes speaks up and they declare that they will follow God. The second half, we this conference here, in order to have a family affair, we must decide to follow God. They clearly see that God is Jehovah Nissi, that God is their battle fighter. Listen to what they say. The people answer, we never forsake God. Never. We never leave God to worship other gods. God is our God. He brought up our ancestors from Egypt. He brought them from slave conditions. He did all those great signs while we watched. He had kept his eye on us. Along the roads we traveled and among the nations we passed through, just for us, he drove out all the nations, Amorites and all, who lived in the land. Count us in, they said. We too are going to worship God. He's our God. He's our battle fighter. He fought our battles. What battles have you had, Smith Chapman? What battles have God fought for you individually and collectively, personally? What battles have God allowed you to overcome? What victories can you look back and claim? Smith Chapel, God's asking this morning, are you committed? Are you all in? Is God your battle fight? Are you depending on him? Prophet told us to lean not to our own understanding. We got to lean on God. We got to trust God to be our battle fight. He'll fight your battles, church. He'll fight your battles if you choose to follow him. In Joshua's fourth point, verses 19 through 21, he admonishes the villagers not to act, not to anger God. He tells them, you can't do it. You're not able to worship God. He is a holy God. He is a jealous God. He won't put up with your fooling around and your sin. When you leave God and take up the worship of foreign God, he'll turn right around and come down on your heart. He'll put an end to you. And after all the good he had done for you, won't you serve him? And the people told Joshua, yes, we will. Yes, we will worship God. The tribes, the villages understood that God was the Jehovah Shalom. He was the giver of peace. In the midst of all of the confusion, he gave them peace. In the midst of today's world, coronavirus, in the midst of floods and hurricanes, in the midst of earthquakes and wars and rumors of the wars, in the midst of political chaos throughout this man and country, God will give us peace. A peace that surpasses all understanding. He will be our Jehovah Shalom. He will give us a peace, a calmness that allows us to stand in the midst of confusion and not be confused. A peace that allows us to look up to the hills from when cometh our help. In the midst of trouble, he will give us a peace that allows us to know that he may not come when we want him. But as grandma used to say, he's always on time. The fifth point that Joshua makes, verses 22 through 24, that he asked the tribes, he asked the villagers to he asked them to invoke God. He asked them to put God first, to let the world know that there's a reality in serving a true and living God. He wants them to make God a part of their daily lives. He wanted them to become witnesses. Listen to his plea to them, and then listen to their answer. And so Joshua addressed the people. You are witnesses against yourselves that you have chosen God for yourselves. You've chosen to worship him. And they said, we are witnesses. Joshua said, now get rid of all the foreign gods you have with you. Say an unqualified yes to God, the God of Israel. The people answered Joshua, we will worship God. What he says, we'll do. Smith Chapel, have you said an unqualified yes to God? Do you acknowledge that God is the source and the strength of your life? Have you acknowledged that without God, you would fail? Have you acknowledged the fact that God woke you up this morning, started you on your way? We've got to acknowledge God. They answered this way, because now they saw God as Jehovah Jireh. Is he your Jehovah Jireh? Is he your provider? When you pray, does he answer? When you're in need, does he provide? When you cry out, does he comfort? He's our provider, church. He provides us with all that we need. He provides us with the food that we need, the water that we drink. He provides us with a way out of no way. He provides us with help when we're down. He provides us with strength when we're weak. He is Jehovah Jireh. He's my provider. Is he yours? The final point, the call to action, is made halfway through the chapter. It's found in the verse that we read as our scripture lesson. It's found in verse 15. It says, if you decide that it's a bad thing to worship God, then choose a God you'd rather serve and do it today. Choose one of the gods your ancestors worship from the country beyond the river, or one of the gods of the Amorites on whose land you're now living. But Joshua went on to say, as for me and my family, we'll worship God. He called them to offer. He called them to return to God. Smith Chapel, as we begin this conference year, we've all done some things that we said we weren't going to do. We all haven't done some things that we said we were going to do. We've all went our own way, did our own thing, told somebody we're 21 plus and nobody can tell us anything. It's time to return to God. If we're going to make a difference this conference year, if we're going to be the village that helps the world become better, then we've got to return to God. He implored them, Joshua implored them, to let all the other gods go. Let them go. Get rid of them. Throw them away and worship God. Jehovah Signu. Worship the Lord, our righteousness. Worship him and him alone. Smith Tapper, do you see God and Jehovah Signu? Is he your righteousness? If he is, then as you celebrate, as we have this family affair this entire conference year, as we party with the Holy Ghost, as you have a family affair, Smith Chapel, don't forget to acknowledge Jehovah Jireh. Jehovah Roha. Don't forget to fear or reverend God, because he is Jehovah Shema. Follow God, that second help said, for he is Jehovah Nisa. A said, do not anger God, for he is Jehovah Shalom. The I tells us, invoke God, for he is Jehovah Jireh. And if you need to, Smith Chapel, individually and or collectively, if you need to return to Jehovah's signal, I declare this morning that if you choose this day to have a lifelong affair, if you choose this day to have a lifelong party with the Holy Ghost, if you choose this day to have a lifelong worship with God, then your living will not be in vain. You will be able one day to say, up on the cross, he died for me. Up from the tomb, he set me free. Up to the throne, he rose for me. Up in heaven, one day I'll see Jesus, my Lord, who loved me. So Smith Chapel, will you lift him up this conference year? Will you lift him up so that others can see that God is able, that God fills his heart and lifts him up? Because Jesus said, if I be lifted up, I'll draw all men unto me. It takes a village. Joshua knew that. But in any village, there are individuals. And individually, we must decide, for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. It takes a village to stand up. It takes a village to speak up. Smith Chapel, will you be that village? Will you be that village here in Eastern Michigan that will worship God in spirit and in truth? Will you be that building that will have a praise party each and every day of your life? Will you be that building that will have a family affair? Will you be that building that will lift up God so that men, women, boys, and girls will see your good work and glorify your Father which is in heaven? Will you today, as we begin this new conference year, will you say like Joshua, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Remember, it takes a village.
I pray that the message blessed you today, that you know that it takes a village. It takes every single one of us playing our part, playing our position to advance the kingdom of God. That God has put greatness inside of you to make God's name great. Great. And so as we get ready to say the benediction today, I'm going to pray that you will allow God to unlock in you what is the piece needed to create the bigger picture in the body of Christ. Let's pray. May the love of God, the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and sweet communion of Holy Spirit continue to inspire us, encourage us, and to guide us towards the purposes and plans that God has for our life. Help us to remember today that we were created on purpose with a purpose, and that God just needs us to link up with some other believers so that we can glorify his name and make God's name great. God has spoken. Let the church say amen. Good morning, Smith Chapel. Here are your announcements for the week. Tuesday morning, 7 a.m., you know what time it is. It is praying time. It's our power prayer call, and I encourage you to hop on that prayer call and kick off your day and your week with power. If you know somebody in need of prayer, you go ahead and send them the information because we want to pray with them. Now, this coming Sunday will be our worship and chill service. I just want to remind you that August has 5 Sundays in the month, and we will be out on the parking lot, but we will also be streaming virtually. And so I want to encourage you to invite somebody to come out with you. You know, make it a fun time. Bring some chairs. You can tailgate. You know, you tailgate at the games. You can tailgate at church, too. And so that will be next Sunday at 10 a.m. Now, I've got a special announcement and request. As we put together our worship and chill services, you see that we are building a stage each week, and we are having to put all the elements out there to keep us cool and dry, the tent. And so our men need volunteers to help. The pastor is appealing to you that if you could, on that Sunday, next Sunday, the 29th will be a great time to start, to come out at 8 o'clock in the morning. I know it's early, but you know what? You are that missing piece of the puzzle that the men need to get this job done. And so I'm going to ask that you would come out and help them with setup. Now, if you've got questions and need more information about it, you can reach out to the pro tem of our trustee board, Brother Don Jones, and he will give you all the information. But if you would meet them at 8 a.m. next Sunday, they'll get everything set up, and then we'll move into our 10 a.m. service. Then there's another project that I'm wanting to ask for your assistance with, and we're calling all men. I'm calling all men. Brothers. Yeah, go ahead. Ooh, I hear that bass. I hear y'all say, hey. Brothers, we need your help. And I want to invite you to join a special meeting on Wednesday, August 25th at 6:30 p.m. with some of our men who are leaders in the church with a project that we could really use some extra hands, some extra legs, feet, and muscles. And so I'm calling all men. I'm specifically talking to some of my young men. Young men, we really, really need your help. And so that meeting will be this Wednesday. The information's up on the screen. You can call into it or you can hop in on Zoom. Wednesday, August 25th at 6:30 p.m. And then on next Monday, 2 Mondays from now, August 30th, will be our official board meeting at 6:30 p.m. This is our first official board meeting in the new conference year, and I need all ministry heads, I need all officers to be on that meeting because we've got a few things to discuss as we continue to move forward into this new year together. Well, those are your announcements. God bless you. I love you. Have an amazing week.